4,000, not more than 1,000 pounds of gold. How many of you have 1,000 pounds of gold laying around? It'd be easier to come up with $1,000 than it would 1,000 pounds of gold. The value of items is based upon what you're willing to give for it. What is money your soul worth? It's worth the life of the Son of God. That is how important you and I are. Well, God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit are sitting around in heaven and talking about how are we going to save man. And Jesus said, I will go to earth and die through crucifixion. That's how much mankind is worth to me. And so Stanphil reminds us that we are the ransomed and we will shine in heaven and we will be there where we will never grow old and we will never wander. Isn't that one of the promises that you look forward to so much? We'll never grow old. John the Apostle writes in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 17, whoever does the will of the Father will live forever. Whoever does the will of the Father will live forever. And there are so many promises in the New Testament that emphasize to us the eternal nature of heaven. Everything that you and I know here on earth has an end to it. We cannot buy a car that will last us forever. We cannot buy a refrigerator that will last forever. But you and I have a spirit within us that will last forever. Forever. Eternal. John 6, verse 51. If we eat of the flesh and drink of the blood of Christ, we will live forever. Just one promise among you. We can get to heaven where we can stop wandering. Life. The only thing that is consistent about life is that it is inconsistent. The only thing that does not change about life is that it always changes. And we experience life that is not dependable. We experience life that is unpredictable. But when we get to heaven, it's going to be predictable. It's going to be dependable. Mr. Stanphil makes a slight mistake when he talks about the streets of gold, because the New Testament book of Revelation is the only book that mentions it. But John only mentions one street of gold. Revelation 21 and verse 21. Small thing. But one street suggests to me that you can't get lost in heaven. You can't get lost there. There's only one street. When we get to heaven, we will be in a surrounding that is familiar. We've never been there before, but it will be familiar because it will be predictable. That wonderful mansion over the hilltop. Of course, the passage that suggests the idea of a mansion is John 14, verses 1 through 3. You see it read to us earlier. And we're familiar with the passage. We can quote several verses, I think, in that passage. Jesus tells the Jews, you believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. The translation could be many rooms. And I go to prepare a place for you. I Googled biggest houses in the world. And some of those huge houses that the millionaires live in can have, 400,000 square feet. That's pretty big. Some of the big, when they start being called palaces, they can have over 2 million square feet. I saw one that had 1,788 rooms. I hate to have to run a vacuum there. Jesus' point here in John chapter 14 that the Father has a mansion or a house with many rooms conveys the idea that there is no world right now to obey the gospel. Heaven is big enough for all 7 billion of us. There is no end to heaven. You don't have to stand in line to get to heaven. There's no waiting. You don't have to take a number. You go to a restaurant, you may have to wait until somebody gets up and leaves the table. There'll be none of that in heaven. The banquet table at which the Messiah sits is big enough for everybody. That mansion over the hilltop. And then we ask ourselves, what do we do in the meantime? We've been ransomed and we look forward to that mansion over the hilltop. And in the meantime, Mr. Stanphil writes that we don't want to be considered poor and lonely or discouraged. Don't think be poor or lonely or deserted. Because Jesus has promised us that we will be rich one day. Romans chapter 10 and verse 12, the Apostle Paul writes that God wants to bestow all of his riches on those who believe in Christ. All of his riches. And in Romans chapter 8, the Apostle Paul pictures you and me being redeemed in Christ as being Jesus' fellow brothers, sisters, being adopted into his family. Now here's the thing about Roman law. Jews did not adopt. So this idea of adoption comes from Roman culture. Under Roman law, an adopted child had the same legal right as natural born children. They could not be written out of the will. They could not be ignored through the will. They had the same legal rights as natural born children. Now you think about that in our relationship to God through Christ. Jesus is God's natural born son. He's the one that deserves heaven. But the promise is that if we are faithful to Christ, then we can have the same riches as the natural born son by his grace. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9, Apostle Paul says that Jesus, although he was rich, accepted the poverty of humanity so that we might become rich. The Son came to earth so that his sons could go to heaven. So don't think me poor or lonely or deserted here on earth. Because I've got the wealth of the Father waiting to be given to me. I'm not discouraged. I'm heaven bound. The Hebrew writer says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 10 that Abraham looked for a city whose builder and neighbor is God. Abraham. Abraham was able to think about heaven long before Jesus came. And he looked forward to being in that celestial city. We don't know what he understood. But he knew that there was something better. He knew there was something better than having to pack up and move your tent and resettle. Pack up your tent, move again, and resettle. He knew there was something better than that. And Jesus comes along and says, I'll make the way for you. And so Mr. Stanfield again says, I'm just a pilgrim and searching the city. And again the Hebrew writer says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13, that all of the patriarchs realized that they were pilgrims and strangers on the earth. You and I need to be reminded of that regularly. We are just passing through. If you feel like that you're not at home sometimes here on earth, if you feel like, I'm not sure I belong here on this earth, good. You shouldn't. Paul says in Philippians 3 and verse 20 that our citizenship is in heaven. And so Peter reminds us, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11, that we as Christians are strangers and pilgrims on earth. Just passing through. This house that we live in right now, we're just going to be here temporarily. And we're going to pack up and move. We're going to go to a better place. That mansion over the hilltop. Were we once that mansion? 6, for you were baptized into Christ, and you put on Christ. Verse 27. And so our robe is washed white in the blood of the Lamb. Revelation 22 and verse 14. And so we're going to put on that robe, that eternal robe that will never be soiled, that will never be tainted by sin anymore once we get to heaven. That robe of righteousness that is given to all those who are in Christ Jesus. And He'll give us the crown. In the Isthmian Games, which were the counterpart to the Olympic Games, but were played at Corinth instead of Athens, the crown was celebrated. Celery played in the crown. I don't know about you, but there's not a lot that would motivate me to get into a foot race for a celery. But the crown that God has reserved for us is the crown of life, James 1 and verse 12. Life, if death in the scriptures are portrayed as separation, life, being a counterpart, is togetherness. That is life. Life, eternal life, is togetherness with God. That's the definition of life. Togetherness with God. And so the crown of life portrays the idea that we're going to be with God forever and ever. Christ and the Holy Spirit and all the good people in the Old Testament and Christians in the New Testament. It's an unfading crown. You know, at some point, the people would have to get rid of that crown of celery. But Peter pitches in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 4 that the crown that you and I are working for is an unfading crown of glory. When Jesus sets glory on our head, as we bow before Him in heaven, because we bow before Him on earth, is the crown of righteousness, 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. The Apostle Paul there is in that Roman prison cell. Apparently he believes that he could be executed any minute. He says, the time of my departure is at hand. And he pictures his life as a sacrifice to God. He says, I am being poured out as a drink offering. But I fought the good fight. I finished the course, and I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me, but not to the other, but all those who perish protected, who run to fear. Do you this morning look forward to the coming of Jesus Christ? You look forward to your mansion over the hilltop. If we do, and I believe all of us do, let's live like it. Let's live tomorrow when we go to work as if we've got that mansion waiting for us over the hilltop. But if you are here this morning, you cannot echo the words of Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. If you say this morning, I'm not ready for Jesus to come.